Hello, everybody. So I'm an engineer with Stripe. Thank you all for coming. I'm going to be showing a demo and walking through the process of doing checkout for your app with an integration of Stripe and Parse. So the idea here is that in your app, for whatever reason, you want to receive money, and there's this necessary checkout flow. Ideally, right? We can all hope. And there's this necessary checkout flow where a user submits to you the credit card information, maybe a billing address, a shipping address, whatever's necessary. And there's this obstacle to buying things on the internet, I think. Just this moment when it's time to actually put in the credit card number and make the whole thing go through. There's some friction there that I don't think anyone's ever completely gotten rid of. And the goal of the checkout experience that we're demoing today, and in fact, we're gonna show some software from Stripe that I don't think has ever been shown to a large audience before, although a couple of our merchants are starting to roll it out. The software that we're gonna show today, I think, is as smooth a checkout experience as you're gonna see anywhere. The way that I think about it, and the way that I think about what Stripe does more generally, is a sort of double-ended simplicity. We want simplicity on the user's end and simplicity on the end of the people designing and producing the app. The simplicity on the user's end is precisely this problem of, is the interface simple enough for me to use that whether or not I go through with the purchase is purely a function of how I feel about the product and not a function of any confusion or hesitation or delay. And then the simplicity on the developer's end is, can I produce an app using Stripe quickly, and can I integrate it with my business in a way that allows everybody in the business, the technical people, the non-technical people, to manage the money side of things quickly and simply in a way that doesn't detract from the heart of your project, which is probably not a money project at its heart, right? It's about something different. My first experience trying to accept money online was I was in fifth grade making a charity to save the rainforest, and I blocked really hard on getting payments to go through on my website, right? When I was making the demo app for today, I thought, wow, like, we really live in the future. The stuff that you can do with Parse in particular, it's really great experience from a developer's side. It's precisely the simplicity. So just a word about Stripe, and I'm gonna introduce some of Stripe's tech, and if you've used Stripe before, which I hope several of you have, you'll be familiar with it, and if you haven't, it should make the whole thing make perfect sense. So what Stripe does is we do payment infrastructure for the internet. And when we think infrastructure, we were trying to think sort of that beautiful modern infrastructure, right? Those great APIs, you can plug right into what you're doing. And I think Stripe has pushed payments forward a lot when it comes to the infrastructure that we expose to developers. The two of our goals that I want to focus on for today, we have this goal of making sort of fully functional integration very, very easy. And we have this second goal of allowing you as the app developer to fully control the flow even at the time when the user is making payments. And this was historically presented this very famous conundrum. And as a result of this conundrum, a lot of websites in the past and even today will send the user off-site to make payments, right? This is a flow that we're all familiar with. And the conundrum is that you as the app designer want to control the flow, you want to control the user experience, you certainly want to control all of the data that is produced as a result of the payment. But you don't want to touch the credit card number with a 10-foot pole, because credit card numbers are enormously legally encumbered, they're regulatory encumbrances. If you store and do work with credit card numbers, it is more headache than you want to endure, unless that's what you do for a living, like us. So you want everything to be yours, but you never want to see the credit card number. So I'm going to talk about how Stripe infrastructure works in the context of Parse, because the app that I wrote for you guys today is, of course, a Parse app. And Parse has this very nice mental model where you've got the user-facing components of the app, you know, whether it's the iOS app, the Android app, the web app, a web app in today's case, that the user actually interacts with. And then you have the cloud backend, and you talk by means of cloud functions, by means of calling particular endpoints, and so on. So when you integrate Stripe with your Parse app, the way that it works is you're going to incorporate into the front end, either into the application code, into the application code, whether it be the mobile app, JavaScript for the web app, et cetera. Client side, you're going to incorporate some Stripe functionality. And then you're also going to plug Stripe into the back end by means of the Stripe cloud module that is shipped by Parse. So if any of you have ever done payments with Parse, you have seen that the right way to do it is to use the Stripe cloud module, which wraps a lot of our API endpoints in Parse objects. So on the front end, what the Stripe code that you insert will do is it will do as much or as little as you want, but it will do at least one thing, which is when the user enters the credit card number, the front end code is going to talk to Stripe and swap out the credit card number with an internal token that from now on will be all that anybody uses to do everything. So it is precisely as functional as a credit card number, but not sensitive in the same way. So your whole backend, your Parse cloud app, is going to be written in terms of tokens. And it's going to think about charging a token, or it's going to think about the token that is owned by a particular person. And now it's all back to you, so to speak. That is, the entire payment process occurs on your website. Nobody is shipped out anywhere to do anything and then come back. And the way that that's accomplished is by having it all be in terms of these tokens. So to continue the flow, what happens is, you know, this token is handed back to the back end as a result of whatever front end logic is going on, whatever the front end checkout experience is. The user goes through with it. They're like, okay, like, I'm going to do it. I'm going to pay the money on the internet. And the token heads on back to the back end. And then you do, using your secret API key, whatever's necessary. Like you charge some amount of money, or you create customer objects in your system, or you set up subscriptions and recurring billing and whatever the logic is that you need to set up. So I'm going to walk through that whole process, but beginning with the front end, because I think this is the bit that all of us on a day-to-day level have bad experiences on the front end when it comes to purchasing things online. It's precisely this friction that I was mentioning earlier. What we want is this double-end simplicity. And the part of that that I think has been hardest historically is simplicity for the user during their checkout experience. So I made a quick little Parse app, you know, just Parse new foobar. And then into index.html, I dumped a little bit of code. So all that this code does is I put a form into the web page. And that form has a text field where you indicate whatever it is that you want to purchase in my simple app. And then I inserted into the form the Stripe checkout JavaScript. Now, what Stripe checkout is it's a project by Stripe. It's not at all necessary to use Stripe checkout if you're using Stripe. But what Stripe checkout does, and I think it's really, really great, is it provides for you, just incorporated into the front end of your app, the actual payment form, the form that collects the credit card information and whichever addresses are necessary, such as a shipping address. And this prevents you from having to reinvent the wheel, and again, allows you to focus on whatever the heart of what you're doing is. So Stripe checkout, the simplest way to plug it into the app is to just drop it into a form, and it will submit a few bonus parameters when the form is submitted. And you see, you load the JavaScript from Stripe, you provide your public key. This is a key that can be used client-side anytime that you want. All that the public key is good for is creating these tokens. Someone who holds the public key can create a token, and they can give that token to you so that you can charge the token. It's a process that the user does to their credit card number to protect it from compromise. So you include the Stripe JavaScript, you include the public key, and you set some parameters however you want. Now, what I'm about to demo is Stripe Checkout version 3, which is this, what I mentioned, it's something that I don't think has ever been demoed for an audience before, although you might have seen it in the wild in a few places. I'd be very excited if some people in the audience wanted to put it out into the wild for us. All right, so let's go to this demo and show what this checkout experience looks like. So this is precisely the rendered version of that code that we were looking at a second ago. I'm on my simple Parse app, and I'll just type in that I want to buy one pony, please. And now this pay with card button is produced by that script that you saw a second ago, as is everything that comes next. So I pay with the card, and I get the little JavaScript widget that is going to allow me to introduce my information. So I'll type in my email address, and this is my actual email address. And I'll type in a card number that is not my actual card number. Those of you who have used Stripe before know that the answer to the life, universe, and everything, repeated many times, provides our test card number. That's a sort of magic number known to Stripe that if you're using test keys, which we are, we'll do all the right things. And I can enter any expiration date that's in the future and a CVC. And now what Checkout V3 provides is this Remember Me checkbox. This is what is new. Because we know that the best way to provide a payment experience is to know the person's payment details already. But the absolute worst way to provide a payment experience is to ask someone to set up a username and password when they go to buy something. It's the worst, because the username you want is never available, and you don't really know what your password should be, and then you forget it, if you're me. So it's, again, this seeming paradox of we want to remember users, but we don't want them to have to do work to make that possible for us. I mean, we should be responsible for making that possible. It shouldn't require extreme effort on their part. So the way that Remember Me works in Stripe's Checkout V3 is this. It asks me for my mobile number, which I will enter in. And at setup time, that's it. We're done now. I will pay my $25 for my pony. It's a really good deal. And this is some endpoint that I've just had it show you what the parameters were that were submitted by the form. You can see that it gets that text field that you as the app developer put in, and it also gets this Stripe token parameter that the Stripe JavaScript has set up for you. And this is the token that you use on the back end to do whatever it is that you want to do. Independent of the fact that we're using test details, even if this were live, no credit card has been charged yet. It has been verified that the credit card information that was entered was valid, but it now remains for you on the back end to decide what you want to do with the valid credit card that is now behind this token. All right, but now the heart of this process, the user has come back, or they are on any other website on the internet that uses Stripe. The first layer of sort of remembrance that we provide is it's possible to have an ongoing session with Stripe. And by clicking Remember Me, I set up a session. And on any Stripe website, my session details are remembered. And it knows my information ahead of time. And this is great because my credit card information is sort of in Fort Knox, so to speak. Or rather, I mean, Stripe has it. But I like to think of it as being in Fort Knox if Stripe has it. And all that I'm doing is I'm saying, please, I'd like you to use that credit card information that you already have to make the payment, which is certainly the most secure way to move credit card information online. But the exciting bit, of course, because this session will time out fairly quickly, or I will be on a different computer or whatever. So I've just logged out. And imagine now that I've gone to a completely new website that also uses Stripe, but that's the only connection. And I want to pay. So here, I'll type in my email address, and bam. So it is going to send me a text message to my phone. and the code is 1782. And now I'm back. The payment flow is already done. And that's what's provided by Stripe Checkout V3. And personally, I think that's the future, to have payment flows that are that painless for the user. And any Stripe merchant who wants can choose to include Stripe Checkout in their website. They can tweak it as much as they want. They can reinvent parts of it to whatever extent that they want. Like, Stripe's API provides sort of complete functionality independent of any Stripe JavaScript that you use on the front end. But this is a very, very nice checkout flow that is available out of the box for people who want it. The code to produce this was, a copy and paste job that took 60 seconds. And this would literally have taken weeks of work when I first tried to accept payments, 10 years ago. So let's dive back into the slides and think more about the code that we need to fully integrate Stripe. So I can customize checkout more than just dropping it into my form. It provides these JavaScript objects that I can use in whatever clever ways I desire. In this particular case, I've used this Stripe checkout object that was exported by loading the JavaScript to set up my own hook to do my own work when a button is clicked. When the Stripe button is clicked, it will call to this handler, which will run precisely that same flow that we just saw, and it will then, that token field you see where I put in the value submit form, that is another event handler that Stripe hands control to when the checkout logic is done. And it will hand that event handler the token that was just generated through the Stripe checkout process, and now your JavaScript is again in full control and can run off to do whatever it wants to do. So you notice that in the previous payment flow, there were no addresses. And it was a misconception of mine before I worked for Stripe that you needed to enter an address to buy things online, which is not true. If you want to get something in the mail, you better enter an address. But it's completely the merchant's option whether to ask for your billing address. They can try to use it as another layer of authentication, and you can contemplate whether that seems like it does anything good for you. But if you want a shipping address, and if you want a billing address, Stripe will again do all of the logic behind that. Because dealing with addresses, I think, is very tricky, right? Because they're in all these different places, and they're in all these different formats, and so on. And it's as simple as asking Stripe Checkout to collect the shipping address and or the billing address. And let's go back to the demo, and I'll show what it looks like if you solicit that information. Essentially the same site, but it is now running the code that we were looking at most recently. I'll say that making new Parse apps was addictively easy, right? I gotta show two different things. I'll just bang out two different Parse apps. It is a very nice process. So here, when I go to pay with my card, it solicits my address, and let's use this email address. Now what I can do, because I want to use different details than the ones I used previously, I can just back out of that phone auth situation and go through the flow normally. I want to ship to my name at San Francisco, let's say. And we'll use the same billing information. And we'll use the same magic card number. And now you can see the information posted by the Stripe form. It kind of smartly breaks out the different details and posts it to your endpoint with the zip code broken out, the country broken out, and so on. So if we go back to the slides, we can now look at sort of on the back end, what are you going to do with all of those details that Stripe is posting? And you know, in main.js, or if you have discipline in whatever, like, or app.js, or maybe some more appropriate place, you'll set up a handler for each of your endpoints. We're going to accept post requests to the pay endpoint. And what we're going to do, and this is the value of Stripe sort of just letting you hold all of the data at all times rather than shipping you off somewhere else for part of the payment experience, is all of the data comes straight through to us, and we'll create a parse object around it, this order object, to record it all, and it'll be available in sort of Parse's web interface to the back end, and then we can do whatever thinking or logic we want around that data. So we populate the order object, but now certainly we need to use that Stripe token, which came back as part of the post, to do whatever it is that we want to do. So what we'll do is we'll load up the Stripe Cloud module, and we will initialize it with the secret key. Unlike the public key, which is what we saw previously on the front end, and which is always safe to expose, the secret key, as the name suggests, is what you should hold close to your chest and what you should use when interacting with Stripe and submitting your own information to Stripe. So we initialize it with the secret key, and now we're just going to use the cloud module. And it's very beautiful because we can express the whole Stripe flow just as a chain of these promises that Parse exposes so nicely. So the first thing that we'll do is we will access the Stripe API endpoint associated with tokens to get all of the information that Stripe has associated with the token that just came back in this form. In this particular case, we just want the email address, which is viewed as information associated with the token. At any point in time, if you hold the token ID, you can get the email address and a few other pieces of information. So we'll get that information, and we'll put it back into our order object for our own bookkeeping. And then, using a dot then, we are going to proceed with the Stripe flow. So the next thing that we'll do is that we're going to create a Stripe customer. An optional part of the payment process, a Stripe customer is essentially a bookkeeping object that you use to associate many charges, many refunds, many bank transfers, so on, with the same human being or whatever you're thinking around it is. So we do want to create a Stripe customer because we're interested in doing lots of bookkeeping and running lots of data. So we'll create a customer. Again, this is wrapping a call to the Stripe customer API endpoint. And we're going to pass in a name, an email, and the quote-unquote credit card number that we have on file for them, which is, of course, just the token ID. Because none of this code, even though it's backend code, it doesn't see credit card numbers. That's the whole miracle of the thing, is you don't have to touch the PCI compliance, which you really want to never do if you can help it. Once the customer is created, we'll do the next step, just by another dot then, and now we'll create an actual charge against that customer. And the charge, we put in just an amount. You know, we imagine the order object exposes this calculate amount method. So we put in the amount, the currency. Stripe is becoming available in more and more countries at this very moment in time, so we're accepting orders now in more and more currencies. The way that the currency situation works is you can accept, whoever you are, you can accept payments from anyone who has a credit card on the internet. Sort of geography and doesn't really matter to being able to accept payments. But the currencies that you can receive are limited by one of two things. Either a currency that you can get paid in because you have elected to create a bank account for that currency type, or some amount of people, an increasing number, and very soon everybody, are using Stripe in sort of full-blown currency exchange mode where you can elect just have Stripe do whatever FX exchanges are necessary to get you precisely the currency that you want. In either case, in many use cases, you're just going to accept USD all the time, so that's what we're doing here. And we create this charge against a particular customer. And then we're done. That's the whole flow. And you can build out your back end to do some bookkeeping for you. Stripe provides, you know, manage.stripe.com, which is an interface into everything that you do through Stripe. And one way or another, you can go and track down those objects that were just created. Because charges, customers, tokens, they're all first-class objects from the perspective of the API and from the internal perspective of Stripe. Go track them down and do whatever you want with them. So both the front end and the back end code that I just showed you are incorporated into this open source example that we have put up on GitHub. And I'm going to demo for you right now the example. So the way that the example works is we recently started selling Stripe t-shirts online. And our developer and a couple of our engineers took a day or two to build out a Stripe shop. And we have sort of open sourced all of the code behind that. So if you guys have actually seen the Stripe shop, we have Stripe employees posing with both the men's t-shirt and the woman's t-shirt, like you see here. And when you come to the shop, you select what shirts it is that you want to buy. And then Stripe Shop is one of a couple places where right now in the wild you will see Stripe's checkout v3. And you will also see it integrated on this GitHub project. So when I go to purchase, I'm logged in from an earlier session that I made today, or I can log out and pretend that I have come to the page afresh. And now having logged out, if I put in that same email, which was foo@bar.com, it will recover my session by texting me. And the verification code in this case is 1800. Or maybe it's not. Oh, sorry, I was looking at an old verification code. It's 0193. And now those details are all recovered from my earlier session. So I'm going to go ahead. Yep, that's also correct. Presto, and now we have a fully functional backend that is running through those promises that we saw a minute ago, customer, charge, and so on. And presto, t-shirt ordered. It's addictively easy. I have ordered too many things in this way. So that's the demo. If we go back to the slide so you can see the link, it's available online. I encourage you to poke around. I encourage you to email me if you're interested in using Checkout v3. It's undocumented at the moment, but fully stable. So I definitely encourage you to use it, but I encourage the flow there to be to email me or email anybody at Stripe that you happen to know or whose email you happen to find online. Because we get some emails, including emails for other companies. So there are definitely a couple Stripe emails bouncing around online in weird contexts. So email one of us, be like, let's do it, and then we'll reply, let's do it, and that'll be the process. So yeah, I'm all done, and I would love to hear questions from any of you guys. Okay, there are a bunch. I'm also going to be around kind of indefinitely after this. So we have microphones just because this is all being recorded, and it makes it easiest if they can record your question.
So it looks like you require the users, or at least the person buying the item, to provide an email address and a phone number?
Yes.
What if they mistyped it?
So if they mistyped it, then they're just back into the situation that the feature didn't exist at all.
Okay.
It's kind of black-holed, right? Like there's this object in our database that's associated with a typoed email address, but when they next go to buy something, they just won't be kicked into this "we remember you" flow, and they'll have to re-enter their information.
But you'll go ahead and process the payment, even if they
As you can see from the fact that I used foo@bar.com, which I don't in fact own, even though I really wish I did, we don't verify the email, because that would require this asynchronous step of emailing you, having you exit the app, go click something to verify that you own the email. So you could type anything into the email field, and your payment will still go through. The same is true for the credit card, for the phone number. You guys had no way to tell this, but I didn't receive any text at the moment that I entered my phone number. only when I came back to the site did I receive a text.
Got it.
I've got two questions. The first question is, I'm working on an app for a client that after they make the purchase, it's going to be quite some time before they can actually pick it up and we want to charge them. So I know I have the token, but how long does the token last?
So the token lasts forever. It's truly like a credit card number, except for not being one. Unless you like delete the token or do something on your side, Stripe will preserve the token forever.
Okay. And then on the integration between Stripe and Parse.
Yes.
I'm using the Parse login, so I'm creating a PF user, and I was wondering if I saw the JavaScript that you just presented, and I was wondering if there's anything that ties together the PF user and the credit card number so we can kind of be hands-off that whole process.
So that's not provided in our demo. We don't have a notion of kind of Parse app users in this open source demo. But you can tie together just, you know, with this, you can use the IDs of Stripe's object, like a customer ID or a token ID, as in the Stripe IDs for those objects, just as data in your app. As long as you're carrying around those IDs, those are like, as a good API would do, those IDs are permanent, they are forever, and they will always give you complete access to those first class objects. So if you record those IDs as part of the state on, say, a user, then you can think of them as a Stripe customer and a user in your app at the same time. Does that answer the question?
Yeah, I mean, I'm thinking.
It does, but I'm also thinking in the instance where people want to say, remember this, my credit card information inside the app, instead of having to go back out. Do you manage that session?
What do you mean by going back out of the app?
In the JavaScript instance, since it's web-based, you'd have to get the text and everything. And so if I ended my session, or if I just wanted to tie that to the session of the PF user and then have him save the credit card information.
So you want to like tie the Stripe checkout session to a session in your app.
Yep.
So that is not something that we expose right now, because the Stripe checkout session is a session with Stripe that will be good across sort of all Stripe websites. So like we serve the cookies associated with that session and so on. But you, if it's very important to you that you sort of don't have that, then the answer would be to not use Stripe checkout, in which case everything will still work great. You'll use like the Stripe JavaScript bindings or the Stripe OS binding, iOS bindings without using checkout, which is fine.
We got a question in the back.
Hi, I just had one quick question with regards to subscription-based payments and the ability to do recurring charges and also metering in terms of like if it's a usage-based payment system where the recurring charges might be different.
Yes.
So say it's like an API service and you want to charge people to use it.
Makes perfect sense. No, we have a lot of people who do metering-based service with Stripe.
Okay, so that's supported?
So like a metered service is not a first-class object for Stripe in the sense that you can't do that logic completely inside the Stripe API, right? There you would be doing some of your own logic on the back end based on whatever data you were recording.
Okay.
And then you'd be using the Stripe API to create whatever charges or so on are appropriate.
Oh, okay, cool. But with the same token, you can do metering.
Yes.
Okay, that
was
the question.
Yes, definitely.
All right, thanks.
Yes.
Yeah, so I think it is okay to sell non-digital goods in app and have a different payment system. I'm not sure. But say, for example, I want to sell t-shirts from an app.
Yeah.
And your demo was mostly web-based.
Yes.
But if it's a native app, is there something that I can use to have the same features as remembering the person?
So a native version of Checkout V3 is in the works. And if you're interested in being like literally the first or second or so on person to use that, shoot me an email afterwards. Okay, if you have I think the people with the microphones will adjudicate who asked the questions. So if you have one, ask.
All right. So my question is, I just started to look into integrating coupons for users, and it seems that right now the API only allows one coupon to be attached to a customer. Is that true? And because basically it's going to be kind of the Uber model where if you give this out to like up to 10 people, then you can get up to $10 coupons. But it looks like I might have to roll my own.
Are you using Stripe directly or using Stripe through some sort of like module or some interface that someone else is providing?
Using it through both Parse and then through some Node and Node NPM.
Okay. So I'm not dead sure how Stripe handles coupons. I hadn't known that we had a coupon API object, although it is plausible. So I'm sorry, I don't know. You can email me or come up afterwards and we can try to get it nailed down.
Okay.
Certainly, I mean, one of the beauties of Stripe is you can accomplish arbitrary logic using the Stripe API in your own backend. And then there's a slightly different question, like, can I do it? And the answer is always yes. Sort of, will you do it for me in a single API call? The answer is like sometimes yes, sometimes no. And if you come up afterwards, you can try to figure out the latter question for coupons, and I'm not sure.
Sure. Cool. Thanks.
Yeah. I see that, so you're starting to support like address, like delivery address and billing address, but I didn't see anything about like picking an address.
Yes.
Like, will you support that later on,
I guess? That's a great, great question. And the question here has been this design question that's been plaguing us back and forth. Now that we're like remembering user state, like how complicated do we allow a user state to become? Like, do they have multiple addresses, and when they come back, they can choose one of their previous addresses, and so on. And the first iteration is precisely what you saw, like not multiple addresses. It is kind of the simplest thing you can do, like not multiple addresses, not multiple cards, like this sort of single set of state, that's what's remembered. And the motivation there was to make it completely effortless in your first experience when you're entering information. Now, there are different camps on what we should do long term and where the complexity should be allowed to emerge. But right now, it's only one address, only one card number.
And do you support at least like addition of this address for the user? The user can edit it like somewhere?
Oh, definitely. So you saw me live sort of edit the state associated with an email address that I entered in the past. And to emphasize the difference between checkout and sort of Stripe mainland, you know, this checkout v3, which I demoed, supports a single address. But each time that an address is entered, like on your particular app, I mean, you see it, you get an order object, you can do whatever you want with it. You can have a list of 500 email addresses, real life addresses associated with a particular user. It's Stripe checkout's v3, like remember me feature that is currently a single address.
So as I see, it's like a credit card payment supports. Any other payment system supported here? Or?
So as in accepting payments through by a particular means. So right now, Stripe only does like credit card / debit card / cards. Especially as we increase the countries in Europe that we support, like we rolled out Germany just a couple days ago. In the U.S., like, how do you pay for things online? Like, you essentially pay with credit cards. And maybe you pay with bitcoins. In Germany and other European countries, there are other forms of payment that are used. And Stripe doesn't currently support any of those things, including Bitcoin, for instance. It does not support. And in the future, it will. And what the timeline is there is, however excited we get about something, then it will happen faster. So you should convince us that there's some non-credit card payment form that's really exciting, and then it will happen. But right now, credit cards have seemed to cover the use cases of, in particular, the merchants that use Stripe. Like, the merchants that use Stripe have been happy being able to charge people just with credit cards so far.
So in the example which you are showing here, you're saying normally when user is coming on your website, they already kind of logged in. They have already their email address provided to us. And then on top of that, when they make a payment, you're asking a separate email address at that point again?
So you can plug your own code into checkout to substitute into those fields so any information that you already hold with the user. In the limit that you already have tons and tons of data recorded, then you probably won't want to use checkout, because the point of checkout is mostly to collect information from the user. I'm not sure, and I would have to think about it, what is the best balance for someone who wants the remember me feature of checkout v3, but already holds all of the data? Because if you already hold all the data, you don't need the remember me feature. So it seems like that's fine. It seems like if you expect to already hold all of the data for a user, then you don't put them through that checkout form that we were just looking at. You know, they press a button and you immediately make the payment on your back end. The checkout form's use case is just collecting the data the first time around. You then have the data stored in your app. You can associate it, as we were saying, with someone's user account in your app or their session in your app or so on. And then when that user, that session, needs the data, you don't have to put them through the checkout form because you already have it.
And Jen, one more additional question there, sorry. Can we also replace using this for the in-app purchases, or it's not possible?
So in-app purchases is definitely possible. A ton of people do in-app purchases. As I mentioned to someone else, checkout v3 in particular doesn't have native support for mobile apps. We have Stripe bindings for all mobile apps. So you can do anything that you can do in Stripe in any mobile app and can make in-app purchases with Stripe. If you want to be like the first person to use checkout v3 in particular in a native app, email me.
V2 is already available. We can use that or no, that's not there.
Can use what, sorry?
V2, version 2.
V2 for checkout? I'm actually not dead sure off the top of my head. I know that we're building checkout, and in particular checkout v3 for mobile apps right now. I'm not sure if we had had native checkout v2 in the past. I would guess yes, but I don't actually know. You'd have to check me.
Thanks.
Hi. Can you talk a little bit about how to deal with credit card fraud and refunds and stuff like that?
Yeah, so this is a very thorny topic in the sense that it's one of the hardest parts of dealing with credit cards online is the potential for fraud. So the way that it works is the sort of final word on fraud is the app maintainer, as in you mitigate or you think about what payments you want to accept based on your own tolerance for risk associated with fraud. Just like you think about what business model you want to have based on your own tolerance for risk associated with fraud. Stripe exposes certainly all of the information associated with each person who's showing up to your site to make payments. And you can use the information to assess whether you think the person is a fraud risk. There are many companies which are not Stripe, things like Sift Science, which provide services that, given the information, will give you their assessment of fraud risk from that person. And those are all, I've seen many of those integrated with Stripe, and the integrations tend to be extremely smooth. Should Stripe sort of try to compete with or replace those companies by doing the fraud assessment ourselves? It hasn't been in the business plan yet. So Stripe won't provide you with like a Stripe certified fraud assessment of a user. Stripe will just provide you with the data to make the assessment yourself or recruit somebody to make it for you. So the question has been, do we have the notion of a Stripe verified user? So until the present moment, like exactly this moment that is happening in this room where we're demoing like remember me features, Stripe hasn't had a notion of kind of keeping track of users or certifying users or anything like that. You can definitely picture it as a future direction now that Stripe is starting to do more to remember users, but it doesn't exist yet. By the way, my little timer this very second ran out, and I think all that means is that it's the ice cream break. But I'm happy to stay here, and if the microphone guys are going to be here, I'll still be on stage taking questions. Otherwise, I'll take them offline. I'm not sure. I'm fine where I am, so you can keep asking questions the way you are.
Cool. So is Stripes, the scope of that, is that simply the, it's just credit card payments, or do you have a shopping bag system that you integrate with Stripe, and is there like a button where if you have to give someone a refund, you can click that and just refunds them? Like, what's the scope of Stripe?
I'm trying to think what the best mental heuristic is so that you can know by thinking about what Stripe does and what Stripe doesn't do. I mean, the answer might just be Google it. In answer to those specific questions, Stripe doesn't provide shopping bag functionality, although we integrate with many kind of build your own shop things, like Shopify, for instance, that provide all of that functionality for their users. We do provide all of the logic associated with refunds, like partial refunds, like, you know, refunding the Stripe fees when you make a refund. Like, if you make a charge and refund it, it's no fees. And I guess the mental heuristic for knowing ahead of time what Stripe does is that sort of all of Stripe will certainly do everything that's kind of like on the back end. If you imagine like you have somebody's credit card and you know sort of, and you've already been in communication with them about like what money they want to pay to you or so on, Stripe will do everything, such as, you know, charging the credit card, recurring charges, subscriptions, refunds, partial refunds, transferring the money out to you at the end of the day, like all of that stuff, or, you know, aborting transfers. This is all done in Stripe's manage interface. Building front-end sites, Stripe provides checkout, which is getting it to be an increasingly exciting product, but checkout is the payment form. And that's historically kind of where Stripe has drawn the line for where its business stops, is we do payments. We don't do, for instance, like website shop constructions. Like, other people do that and we integrate with them.